welcome to this lecture. In this lecture, we're going to do a review of the last few chapters, especially some rhythm principles, as well as minor keys and minor scales and the forms of the minor. I was looking through the last exam and over the homework, I saw some common mistakes, and I want to address those right now. The first big thing I saw was in figuring out intervals in this little melody we had on the exam. And I'm not sure if what this was the problem for a lot of people were, but I noticed that that some of the intervals, they got major and minor mixed up. And I'm assuming it's because they weren't thinking of the key signature. And I can't stress this enough. These accidentals tell us what notes are lowered from like in the key of C or something, where in the piano they're white notes. They're lowered a half step, so they're a different note. So this is not an A, it's an A flat. That's an E flat, that's an A flat. You know, that's a D flat, B flat, G, E flat, E flat. You got to keep the key signature in mind. And let me just stress it one more time. I keep hammering away at this because I'm still seeing people, there's some people who don't know this, but you've got to know your key signatures, and you have to know them a particular way, the way in which I'm teaching them. B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat, G flat, C flat, F flat. If you can't say it, the key signature that fast in order, you're in trouble. F sharp, C sharp, G sharp, D sharp, A sharp, E sharp, B sharp. You got to be able to do that. If I say key of E, you go F sharp, C sharp, G sharp, D sharp. Key of B, five sharps, F sharp, C sharp, G sharp. That's what you have to be able to do. If you can't do that, you're in trouble. Get on it. All right. The second thing while I'm addressing this, let me just say this. What I have noticed every year I've been teaching for a couple of decades now at the university level, and before that I taught elsewhere, but what I've noticed is every semester I have a group of kids, students, who do the work, they come to class. In this case, they watch the video, they do the work, they turn their assignments in on time, sometimes even early. They're organized, they're doing it, and they're all doing well. And then I usually have a group of kids who don't come to class consistently. They have high absentee rate, don't get all their work done. They don't tend to do as well. And then I have kids who try to come and they're trying working really hard, but they don't get their assignments in. They're not keeping up with the work. They usually don't do well either. So you're in college now, and you're not in high school anymore, and you're the one who's having to take the initiative. In our home, we have a saying. One of the sayings my wife came up with, all as long as I can remember, you know, our boys know it like this, is initiative makes you a hero. Initiative makes you a hero. And that really impacted my life, you know, for me, because I'm normal kind of a guy too, and not organized, and it was hard. And so, boy, initiative makes you a hero. So get on it, all right? For me, it's an act of worship, you know, what I do, trying to get organized, trying to keep things together. It's an act of worship for me. I'm submitting it to the Lord. And that's how I look at my, you know, what I'm doing at my work. Because however you act now, what I've noticed, it was for me and for most people I know, the way you proceed through college is indicative of how you're going to do after college. So not being prepared, not getting the work done. You know, this isn't just about college. This is about actually making a living, you know, learning how to be organized, learning how to plan ahead and to make sure you understand the directions and that you're not skipping things. And make sure you understand directions. I mean, if you've ever done your income taxes, which you probably haven't, but you will be, you got to read the details. You got to check it out. So enough soapbox. I just can't stress it enough. Stay on top of this stuff. Plan out your days. Figure out a time when you can do this. Don't get lazy. Don't blow it off. If you do the work, there's less stress. The stress comes when you don't do it and you have to catch up. That's very stressful. You don't want to be in that boat. All right. I'm going to shut up now. All right. So the key signature. So in this interval here is not A to C, which is a minor third, right? A to C is a minor third. A to C sharp is a major third. This is A flat to C. That's a major third interval. In the key of A flat, which actually we are in the key of A flat. A flat to C is the third note in the scale. So that makes it a major third. This is C to E flat, not C to E. Well, C to E is a major third because in the key of C, E is the third note. This is C to E flat, makes it a minor third. This is a minor third. All right, so this is a major third. Now, I want you to notice when I'm drawing my intervals, my capital M is major, and I make my number smaller, so there's no doubt. Because so many people, their lowercase m and uppercase m's look the same. And so you really want to make sure there's a difference. That's why I say always put a dash over your lowercase m, because it really helps. There's people that I'm having to count off because I don't know what they meant. It's difficult to see if it's major or minor. And if I have to guess, if any teacher has to guess, it's going to be wrong, right? All right, so this one's E flat to A flat. Well, in the key of E flat, B flat, E flat, A flat. Oh, A flat. So A flat's the fourth note. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is a perfect fourth. There is no such thing as a major or minor fourth. There is no such thing. They don't exist. Never have existed. They will never exist. Perfect. Fourths and fifths are perfect. Now, they can be diminished and augmented. Diminished, augmented. But they're not major minor. If you put a major minor, that's absolutely wrong. Okay. F to A flat. Well, in the key of F, which is what key signature? It's one flat, B flat. So F to A is a major third. F to A is a major third. F, G, A, B flat, C. Gotta know your scales. Gotta know your scales. So this is a major third. This is a minor third. So lowercase m with a dash, 3. This is a D flat to F. Give D flat, B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat, G flat. Well, F's just F. All right. B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat, G flat. Oh, that's so. D flat to F is a major third. D flat to B flat. B flat. Oh, that's in the scale. So that tells me, oh, that's in the major scale. What note is it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is a major sixth. That's how you do it. You got to know your key signature. You got to know your key signatures and scales. That takes time just memorizing it. G to B flat. G to B flat. Well, what's the key signature for G? F sharp. Oh, but that's a B flat. So G to B is a major third. G to B flat is a minor third, lowercase m with a dash. So now that's there. What is this note? E flat to G is a major third. E flat to E flat is a perfect octave. It's a P8, perfect octave. G to E flat, well, we've already said, what's the key of G? One sharp, F sharp. So that's some kind of, it's in the key. It's in this belongs in the key of G major. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is a major six as well. G to A flat. And quite a few people miss that. They're thinking A. I know. It's an A. No, it's A flat. That is a minor second. Okay. So first of all, you got to know your key signatures. And at the same time, you have to know your scales. And then when you're doing all this stuff, you're working with triads and chords and all this stuff, you got to know what key you're in. And what the accidentals look like in that key. So when you look at a note, you don't. So many people go, "Oh, that's a B." No, it's not. It's not a B. A B is here. Ba. This is a B flat. Ba. They're two different notes. They just happen to have the first letter is the same, but they're not the same notes. All right. So don't get in the habit of looking at some. That's why I say do not learn your accidentals by saying B-E-A-D, don't do it. It will mess you up. You got to think B-flat, E-flat, A-flat, D-flat, G-flat, C-flat, F-flat. F-sharp, don't say F-C-G-D. You will mess you up. You will make mistakes. Trust me, I've been doing this a long time. I've seen them over and over again. All right, let us continue on. All right, so here we have an interval. All right, this is the C. Now I'm going to figure the interval. Now, first of all, I know it's a fourth. 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's going to be perfect or it's going to be augmented diminished.
All right.
So key of C, C to F is a perfect fourth, which makes this an augmented fourth because it got right, the interval, it got, there's more space between them. A flat to F, well, in the key of A flat, what does F look like? B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat. Oh, F's just F. So this is a major something. One, two, three, four, major six. D, all right, so one, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Some kind of seven. So I know it's either major, minor, or diminished or augmented. It's not perfect. It's major, minor, or diminished augmented. So let's see. In the key of D, what is a major seventh? F sharp, C sharp. Oh, D to C sharp is a major seventh. So D to C is a minor seventh. So this is a diminished seventh because it's D to C flat. A to B flat, that is a minor second. A minor second. All right. Notice I put the flat out in front of it. You might think, well, why didn't you just squish it in here? Remember, we don't squish flats or sharps. We don't squish them. Mm-hmm. So this is how you would write something that's right next to each other. You'd put the accidental on the same line. That's why it's so important that you put your accidentals right in front of the note, not above it or below it. I'm still seeing people putting accidentals above the kind of above the note or below. You don't do that. It has to be right in line with the note. It's just like a note. It's not an add-on to a note. It is part of the note. If you have a B flat, it isn't the same note as a B, so you have to have that flat right on the line. See that? The line is going right through it, both these things, because they belong together. Now, we have to separate them in this case because I can't get it. This is how you would do a harmonic second. The notes are right together. So you have to put this out in front of it, but you have to put it right on the line. Mm-hmm. Now, if I spaced them out like a melodic interval, where there was space between them, then yes, I could put it right in front of it. You always want the accidental to be right in front of it, and right in the same position. If it's a space note, that accidental has to be right in front of that, on that same space. It's very important. Okay. While I'm on that thing about key signatures, these are the ways in which we designate key signatures, and even, well, I won't say that yet, but key signatures, scales, that is always a major key. Just a capital letter is always major. A capital letter with a lowercase m is a minor key. Or you can write it with a lowercase m. And that's more of a modern way of doing it nowadays. This is more how it's been for like forever. And this is a way it's just happened in the last couple of decades. You'll see that now. You'll see E minor. It's lowercase E with an m, which looks to me, I don't really like it because when you get into stuff like this, oh, B flat minor. I'm like, that looks weird to me. So anyway, but that's how it is. You know, I'm still doing this because this is also how you designate chords, triads, you know, lead sheet symbols. All right. We don't use that for lead sheet symbols. We use these for key signatures. But this is how we write actual chords, like how you play with, you know, on top of a song, lead sheet symbols. Always a capital letter, and then the lowercase m says it's minor. All right, but you'll get into that. We'll get into that more later. All right, the other thing I want to look at real quick here is the still have people struggling with compound time. And I know it's a suspicion. The people I saw who were missing this are people who have not turned in the homework consistently, so I have a funny feeling. The reason why they don't know this is they just missed one of the videos, more than one video, and so they don't really know it. But we're going to go over it again, and for those of you who feel comfortable with it, just bear with me for a minute, all right? So how we count compound time, all right? So 9-4 time, first of all, 9-4 time is a 9 at the top, so that means how many beats the measure. This is triple time. This is 3 beats to the measure, triple meter, all right? Triple meter, 9 means 3 beats to the measure, triple meter. 4 means there's 3 quarter notes in every beat. There are 3 quarter notes in every beat. So, a dotted half note is equal to 3 quarter notes. So that is 1 beat. because that's 1, right? And that's all of B1. This is 3/4 notes, so that's B2. So I would put a 1 down here. Now, there was a tie on the exam, and so I would put a 2 here, and I still have people not putting parentheses around beat notes. And on the exam, final exam, I'm going to be counting off if you don't put parentheses around your beat notes. If it's a beat, if it's the beginning of a beat and it's a number and there's nothing, a rest or something or a tie, you got to put a parentheses around it. All right. And then this would be, and how we count compound time, we don't say one law, one and, two and, that kind of thing. That's for simple time. Here we say lawly. All right. That's the division of the beat. There's beat 2 right there. Here's beat 1. Here's beat 2. Here's beat 3. Quarter and then a half, which this would be 3 with the parentheses around it, and that would be la, and then li is in here someplace. This note takes that place. Mm-hmm. Now, on the exam, it said transcribe it to 9/8 time. 9/8 time, all right? So now, 9/8 time, there's still 3 beats to the measure, but now it's 3/8 notes. Every beat is comprised of 3/8 notes, or the equivalent, like one sound, one note happening for those 3 pulses, boom, you know, would be 3/8 notes is equal to a dotted quarter note. So this, in 9/8 time, would be a dotted quarter note. That's beat 1. It's tied over, and this would be, they're 3/8 notes, because in compound time, the bottom number tells me, oh, the beat has 3 of those. And the beat, the one note, just one sound on a beat, would be the equivalent of 3 of these. So that's what this is. That's the beat note. That's one beat. Now here it's split up into 3 parts. Da, 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 da. We count, we'd say 2, and there, here's the la, and here's the li. And then here, we'd have an 1/8 rest. And then this would be a quarter note. That's one eighth, and there's 2/8 right there. So there's 3/8 together. So remember, in compound time, we do not count 1 and 2 and 3. It's 1 lolly, 2 lolly. If we have more, if we split up even further, which we did someplace else, and we had something like this. I think it was on the next page. We were in 6/8 time. So this is 6/8 time right here, 9/8 time. This is 1 lolly. Oh, sorry. I did that wrong. I got too many. All right. So this would be 2/16, 2/16, 8. And I'm in 6/8 time. That's going to be 1, and here's la, and there's li. So this can be 1 ta la ta li. 1 ta la ta li ta 2 ta la ta li ta. Now ta is that we call that a ta because we haven't gotten to the law yet. There's all of 1, here's all of la, and there's just 1, there's an 1/8 note, there's that's li right there. Alright? Now if there had been another note over here, still happening on the same pulse, we would say this would be a ta. So 1 ta la ta li ta 2 ta la li. So yes, if we further divide the pulses, then we have to say something in between the las and the lis, because we haven't gotten to the la or li or whatever happens to be. So it's got to be 1 ta la ta li ta. 1 ta la ta li ta, all right? Compound time. Never, ever, 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 ever count compound time. 1 and 2 and 3. Never. Don't do it. It's wrong. All right, let's see what else. Yeah, that costs some people a lot of points because they were trying to count it like simple times. Like, no. Pretty much everybody got the scale degree name, all right, in the key of G, what we call the E. Key of G, the E would be the sub mediant. What would be the supertonic in the key of F? Well, that would be a G. What's the leading tone in the key of E flat? Well, key of a leading tone in the key of E flat would be D, right? All right. So let's don't forget that. All right, now let's go to the minor, the forms of the minor. I'm going to go through this. That's a homework page, and this is very important that you understand the minor forms. I want to go through them because most people did pretty good. Then, but I'm going to cover some of the consistent problems I saw. Whoops, I messed up there. All right. So here's forms of the minor. Let's see. We'll go to 1A. The first thing we had up here was G minor. It was G minor. Now remember, once again, go over it again. Minor forms of the minor. Natural minor is whatever happens naturally because of the key signature. Okay? It's whatever the key signature says, that's what the accidentals are. So in this case, we're in the key of G minor. All right, the key of G minor. I go up a step and a half to the relative major, a step and a half up from G to find the relative major. You go up to find the major. One whole step and then a half step. And it's got to be the skipping a letter name, okay? So, you know, you can't go G to A sharp. No, it's G to B flat, all right? G to B flat. It's got to be a B something. G, A, B. Oh, it's B flat. A whole step and a half step. Key of B flat is B flat and E flat. All right, so I already had the notes already written out for you. All right, so this is the natural minor. We have B flat and E flat. There's your natural minor. All right. A relative major is B flat major, G minor. All right. So we could write a little G down here, or we write a G with a lowercase m. And in that case, we don't draw a line over the M when you're designating keys or chords symbols, all right? And the reason is because we don't call the major a capital M. When you're talking about a G major, you would just write G. That's it. You don't put the capital M there, all right? So when we write minor, we'll write minor chords for guitar, piano, whatever, lowercase m, we don't need to put a dash over the top. Because we already know, oh, it's not major, because major is this. That's a major. And that's a minor. Now, we're talking about identifying key signatures and also and scales and also chord symbols on top of the music to play. That's a major, and this is a minor. Now, when we're dealing with intervals, that's when we put a lowercase m with a dash over it, intervals, because you have majors, major and minors. But when it comes to key signatures and chord symbols, you don't put the line over the lower M, lowercase M, okay? All right, let's go back to this. Natural minor, just wasn't key signature. Harmonic minor, smash this stuff pretty close together. We go B flat, and then we go E flat, and then we raise the seventh pitch. We raise it a half step. In this case, it's an F, so we have to raise it a half step. We go F sharp. There's your harmonic minor. Now, why is it called the harmonic minor? Why? Because the harmony was changed. What harmony? The five chord and the seventh chord. The five chord and the seventh chord were changed. They're related to one another. And so that seventh note in the chord gets changed. All right? And because of that, we come up with this weird interval, I mean, a weird scale, because we're trying to show what happened in this song at this particular point in the music. So here's G minor. Here's the four chord. Here's the natural minor. And here's back to one. But the harmonic minor happened. The reason why we have a scale that says harmonic minor is because this is what happened in music. Right there. Instead of this, we have this. That seventh note got raised because of the harmony, the chord. Because the triad they used, they wanted a major triad. So if the question says, why is there a harmonic minor? The answer is because the harmony changed. The five chord became, they made it a major chord instead of a minor chord like it's supposed to be. Made it a major chord. And that seventh, raised seventh note was in, it's right in the middle of that chord. So now we have the harmonic minor. The harmony got changed. What harmony? The five chord and the seven chord. The five chord and the seven chord is seven diminished. It happens on the five and the seven. That chord, those chords change the harmony. So we had to write a scale to show that. This is what this is. And once again, we don't take these scales like this and go, let me write a song with this scale. That's not how it operates. It's just that when you're using that particular chord right there. Oh, I'm in harmonic minor. Oh, there is natural minor. All right. We do the scale so we can show, oh, this is what it looks like right there in that point in music. All right, but because of this raised seventh, we have a problem with the melody, with the melodic line. All right, right here. What's the problem? This is going to be on the exam, so you got to know this. What happened? Why do we have the melodic form of the minor? Why do we have the melodic form of the minor? Because of the augmented second interval that this produced. When I'm playing these chords, that was a no-no. All right. So how are we going to, interestingly enough, when I've been studying minor songs, major keys, it's very common to go, it's just sort of common. Happens all the time. But minor, you don't see that happening a lot. Over those particular, like the notes right in here, you don't see them. Because of that odd interval. You might hear, da 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 da. You might see that. Or you might see, ba da da, D, F sharp, G. You'll see that. But they'll skip this weird little interval. All right, so like, okay, so what if we do want to use those two notes? How are we going to do it? What are we going to do with that? Do we go back to the natural minor? Well, that's one way you could do it, yeah. Okay, well, but I want to use that chord. Ah, solution. The melodic form. That's where the melodic form of the minor comes from because of this augmented second problem. This is very important, and you know this, all right? Because of the augmented second problem, which is brought about by the use of these chords in the harmonic minor, the melodic form of the minor, they said, let's do two things. We can go one of two ways. We can either go back to the natural minor and just get rid of that note, but then we'd have to use that minor chord. We have to use that minor chord. Well, I don't want to use the minor chord. I want to use that major chord. If I was going G, F sharp, and I want to go down to the E flat, it's like, that doesn't gotta sound good. Oh, you want to use that chord, but you want to use those notes in your little melody line? Yeah, okay. Here's what we'll do. Let's keep that seventh note raised, and let's raise this one. So now basically what we have right here, for these, now what we've done, this is right out of G major. That's right out of G major. So what we did was we took the notes of G major and plopped them in here in the minor, and we call this the melodic form because we're going to get rid of this problem. All right. Well, of course, on the back side, we have to go, well, let's put this back down to natural, and we're going to make this a flat because that's another way of solving the problem. So what this shows us by using an up and down, you know, ascending and descending scale form will show, oh, here is sixth and seventh notes are raised here, or you could lower them back down to the natural minor. This is this exactly. And the thing about in the natural minor, in a melodic minor form, you could have both of these happening. Yeah. So both of those guys, because what this does is get rid of that problem. But here I can still use that chord and this chord here. Here, I would just take it back down the natural. So, you know, when I was in college, I thought So does it always have to go? It confused me when I was actually studying music. Like, I'm like, hey, he's going down and he's got the raised sixth and seventh. Hey, that's not what I was taught. He was like, no, that's because you can use this up or down, and you can use this up or down. It doesn't matter as long as you raise both of them or you lower both of them. And that gets rid of, because this is the answer. You're getting rid of that problem, that weird problem, which comes about because you're using this. All right. So that's the three forms of the minor. All right. So on the melodic form, you're going up, you raise sixth and seventh. On the back side, you lower them back down. And you need to use accidentals to show that. Don't just put an F, because I'll still think, or we'll th oh, you, does he really know? It should be an F natural, not F sharp over here. So be sure and use accidentals on the back side. And like I say, in real life, it works both ways. Because, I think I've said this now five times, this is the problem the melodic form of the minor is taking care of. It's fixing the problem of the augmented second. All right? The harmonic minor form is here because they like that chord. They like the harmony of that five chord and the seven chord. Use it all the time. Because of that, we came up, the music theory people came up with a scale that shows this is what's happening right here. This note got raised because of five. And that's just normal. All right. Just remember to use accidentals when you're showing your changes, when you're writing out forms of the minor. Okay? It's very important. Okay, I think that is it for now on that. We've done a review. And all right, and I've gone 32 minutes, so and I'll narrow that down. Now let's see. Anything else I want to cover before we get into okay. All right, thanks for hanging out with me.